So hi, welcome. As was mentioned, I was asked to give this pretty much at the last minute. So instead of Nicole Harris, you'll have to do with me. And to kick things off, I'm going to talk about something that's terribly exciting, or maybe not. It's about governance. It's sort of like talking about the politics of... So hopefully it'll be fun and interesting, and this is an important topic now, I think, because things have recently changed after a long, long time of not changing and pretty much just working. So a few words about myself. I'm a programmer and a manager, and I do educational technology. I'm running a startup called Foolproof now. The most important thing here is I'm a core developer of Python for a few years now, and I've been using Python for a long time. So I'm going to try to give sort of a little bit of an insider's view of how Python is developed, how all the different mechanisms work, and what has changed in regards to governance and where we are now. So this is Guido van Rossum. Most of you know who that is, right? He's the creator of the Python language and our benevolent dictator for life, meaning he pretty much makes all of the decisions. Except not really. Actually, there's more going on, and this is shamelessly stolen from Shauna Gordon McKeon's talk, recent talk at PyCon US about governance. So thank you, Shauna. So there are two major organizations that take care of things related to Python developing of Python. One is the core developers, and the contributors, and the other is the PSF, the Python Software Foundation. So just a few words about what these are and sort of what the division of labor between them is and responsibilities. The PSF mostly deals with intellectual property, fundraising, funding, infrastructure, community building. They fund events like PyCon US and other events and so on. They have a president and a board and officers, and they make all sorts of decisions. But they're not directly involved in the actual development of the language and the implementation and so on. That is what the core developers do with the contributors. The core developers are sort of the guys with the commit permissions. We can directly make changes to the code base. And then at the top is the BDFL, Guido, who has the final word, but he sort of made sure the project, the day-to-day of running the development of Python, can work without him. It sort of runs itself. The core developers have everything they need to get everything done. They can make most of the decisions by themselves and bring things up when they need to for more discussion and for his final decision. Until July 12th of last summer, when Guido said this, okay, no, not really. Guido wrote an email to the Python committers mailing list, which is only our core developers can write there, but it's open, the archives are open, anyone can read it. And he basically said, I've had enough of this. I've been doing this for 28 years, and I'm done making all the decisions, having all the authority, the final authority. As you can see, he said, I'm giving myself a permanent vacation, and that was not entirely clear. He didn't say he was leaving. He didn't quit, but he's not the BDFL anymore. He's not making all of the final decisions. He also said, I'm not going to appoint a successor. And we had no plan for the day after Guido stopped being the BDFL. And he said, you know what, you're the core devs, I'm sure you'll figure something out, and I'm just going to let you do whatever you want. I'm not going to say anything about what I think you should do. And I'm tired and I need a very long break. Okay, so this was sort of a strange place to find himself, and this was very sudden. I didn't mention this. This came a day after Guido pronounced about PEP 572. Which is about the walrus operator. Seriously, I'm not joking. But this was very, very contentious. There was a ton of discussion. It got very negative. People were saying, if people use this, if this goes into the language and people will use this, I will refuse to review their code. I mean, the discussion, that's just one example. The discussion got very heated, very negative in some cases, and which is unusual for this community. It's usually very positive. And that's sort of what got pushed this to happen earlier than it would have otherwise. So suddenly we were without our leader and with no idea of, no plan of what to do here. So who will lead this project? But more than that, how will that, what form of governance? I mean, okay, there's de facto, there was the BDFL who made all the decisions, but that's because he started the language. It sort of grew, this model grew around him naturally, but is that really the model we should be continuing to use? And how do we even make this decision? I mean, wait a minute, there's no one, Guido was making all these decisions for us until now. How do we even decide how to make decisions from now on? So there was a lot of discussion going on immediately after this. But mostly, another thing that came up is, what the hell is governance anyways? I mean, what do we mean when we say governing the development of Python? What was, because Guido did also, Guido did a lot of things. He did, he gave vision and leadership, and he made technical decisions, and he actually developed things like async.io, he led that. And he made decisions on PEPs, and he did so much. Very early on, it was understood that we're not just going to find a new BDFL to replace Guido. Partly because there's no one like Guido who's been doing this for 28 years, who knows the inside and out, every inside and out and technical detail about Python. And also because this is just a really, really big project now. I mean, Python is one of the most popular languages in the world, and it's a huge project by now. So this was something that was actively discussed. And Guido said something about this in his email. He said, the most important things are probably how are PEPs decided and how are new core developers inducted, accepted. A few words about PEPs. Does everyone know what a PEP is? A PEP? Who knows what PEP 8 is? All right. So it's sort of like an RFC, an official document proposing a change around which these are high-level important changes to the Python language are written as PEPs, discussed and then pronounced upon at a certain stage. Often by Guido, but increasingly over time, he would choose a BDFL delegate for a PEP, which is basically an expert on the who would make this decision for him. So this is the process for most of the major changes, so this is an important point. And our first reactions was really just being sad. I mean, Guido was like the father of this project. Lots of us, Python had a huge influence on our careers and on our lives. So Guido stepping down was a very sad moment. And a lot of people thanked him very sincerely, which was, I think, very very nice to see. And confusion, because like I mentioned, we didn't know what to do really. So we thought, well, let's first take a look at what other projects do, because there are lots of rather large open source projects out there, and many of them have already dealt with this. Let's see what we can learn from them. So we wrote a PEP, because that's what we do. PEP 8000 and onward are all about the governance discussion and selection method and deciding how to decide. And these are all, I mean, this I'll get to it at the end. The decision has already been made. So all of these are for historical reasons by now, because the final PEP encoding, what we have decided, is not in the 8000 range. So PEP 8000 is the how we are going to go about this process. It's a really high overview. And at the end, this was all codified in PEP 13, which is sort of like the constitution of the Python development. So first we wrote PEP 8002, which is a review of other projects. With summaries, this is really interesting to read. It's got a lot of, it came about because lots of core developers went and interviewed people from other projects, and did a thorough job of understanding how they manage their projects. So this is very interesting. And we looked at a lot of projects, and as a bonus, how Microsoft manages internally. And this really affected, you'll see that this had a major effect. So the process we decided upon was, let's first decide how to decide. Let's decide on a process on how we'll make this decision, then vote on it, vote on which kind of governance we want, and then if we need to, vote on who the leaders would be. So sort of to give this a framework, we need to decide how to decide and then choose our form of government and then choose who's in charge. Again, this is stolen from Shauna's talk on the subject. In the US, there was the Constitutional Convention in Philadelphia. They came together, they wrote the US Constitution, which is what is their governance model, the governance model for the US, and then they had elections for the president and the Senate and Congress and the Supreme Court and so on, all the people in charge. So what is the governance voting process? The PP 8001 describes it in detail. It says we're voting for a governance method. We, meaning the core developers, the vote will be in the first 2 weeks of December using an online system called CIVS, which stands for the Condorcet something something system. Condorcet Internet Voting System. And how? Specifically using a pure Condorcet voting system. I'll get into what that means. The reason I would like to point out that the reason the core developers vote is not just historically because the core developers have the power in this in the project, but the thought was the core developers were the ones who are going to really be affected by this very much. This is going to change how the workflows are, how decisions are made. And so we're the ones who really have a deep interest in getting this right. And opening this up to the public would sort of perhaps make it a popularity contest, having a lot of people who aren't involved in the day-to-day making this decision didn't feel right. And on the other hand, there wasn't anyone else. There was the PSF, and there was some thought maybe we could have the PSF sort of help us with this decision, but again, this was mostly about the development itself, which isn't what the PSF does. So having the decision made by the core devs seemed right. So I'll just go over a bit about the governance models that were brought up. At first, these three models were suggested. The first was pretty much, let's get a new BDFL. That's obvious, except he'll also have a council of three people sort of to help him and also to kick him out if he sucks. And these will all have to be core devs. The second suggestion was to have a trio of Pythonistas where, okay, instead of a BDFL, we have three people. They're elected for 5 years and they're elected as a slate, meaning each three people run as a single unit. And then the election chooses a trio together. The idea being that they will get three people who agreed before on how they would work together and hopefully would work together well. And then there was a community governance model, which is the most distributed. It builds on the existing experts index and makes that more formal and gives more power to the experts. The experts would be the one pronouncing on PEPs, usually. And the final authority would be with core devs. They can veto a decision if they don't like it. Some interesting tidbits from these PPs, because this is rather dull, but so PP, the first one, the new BDFL, decided to call him the Guido, the gracious umpire influencing decisions officer, and he would be overseen by the COP, the Council of Pythonistas. PP 811 said, being a genius is not a requirement for being in the council. Referring to some people saying, well, Guido is a genius and we can't find another genius. And 8012 said, the least worst This is the least worst governance model. And these are literally in the PEPs themselves. This is not from side discussions, or this is really there. So, and I think this is something that one of the reasons I am a Python core developer is that the Python community always brings some humor into everything it does, including like the most serious things. And you can see it everywhere here in all these documents and all in all of the discussions and process. And then, you know, as the discussion went on and as we looked at what the other projects were doing, we came up with four more governance models. So we had seven. That's a lot more than people were expecting early on. So there was the external governance model, which was really strange. Let's let the people making all decisions about the development themselves, the development, not be core devs. They have to not be core devs. Let's elect like 2 to 4 people and let them make the decisions. But they will be selected by the core devs. The commons governance model, which is actually should be called the anarchist governance model, except anarchist was deemed to be have a negative connotation, basically means there is a council of elders, but all they do every time there's a big decision to make, they, on a case-to-case basis, try to feel if there's a consensus. And if there is, they say, okay, there's enough information, it seems like there's a consensus, let's do this. And if there's not, then they'll say, let's not do this, or let's discuss it more, or whatever. And they do this on each case individually, the idea being, instead of trying to formalize what it takes to make a decision, let's just say, okay, these people eventually make the decision, but I mean, let's not try to foresee what that will require. Let's let them just decide as they hit whenever it comes up. Then there's also organization of the Python community, which had a 5-member steering committee and elections and so on. But the emphasis there being on teams, creating working groups for different subjects, who would be experts on that subject, and they would lead the development of those areas and make decisions about PEPs. And the final model is the steering council model, where again, there's a 5-member council of core developers, but they have the broad authority. They're sort of like the BDFL replacement. They are going to make all of the decisions, but it is explicitly written that they should make as few decisions as possible directly. They should be focused on putting in processes so that things can work sort of by themselves without them having to make all these decisions directly. And that's why they're called the steering council. So we have all these different models, and there's a few more nice little things that came up, especially around the anarchist governance model. And I just brought this whole piece, wall of text, because it's just wonderful. The picture you should have in mind is a sizable group of peasants discussing some plan for the future in a village green on a warm summer evening, after which a vote is taken and the village elders pronounce the outcome, then the banquet begins and everyone drinks. So sort of like this. And if you don't know this scene from The Holy Grail, go watch The Holy Grail by Monty Python. So going back to what is governance anyways, a lot of things came up during the discussion. It's vision and leadership and language design. It's PEP process and who makes the final decisions. Who can be a core developer anyways, because this is a group with a lot of power. Who the elected bodies are, what are their terms, how are they re-elected, how are they ousted if we don't like them. And who has the final power? Who has the final say? If things go south, who gets to make the final decision? But then we also had to choose an election system. This was sort of like a technical detail, but we ended up investing a lot of time and thought and effort into choosing one. Because a single vote first past the vote system, which is sort of like we use for most political elections, didn't seem like a good option. Because a lot of people said, well, there are probably going to be several of these models that I'm going to like and several that I'm really not going to like, but I don't want to choose just one. So initially, it was suggested to use IRV, instant runoff voting, which is a system which allows you to sort of choose several or rank them. It's a more complex system. It was used occasionally around the world, and it is used by a lot of important open source projects, which was a reason it was suggested. Okay, Debian and Ubuntu and like lots of Linux distros use this for their decisions, their elections. So people said, let's just use this because it's good enough, and these other high-profile projects are using it. And this is where this is my major contribution to this process. I opened this for further discussion, and we ended up going with a Condorcet method, or what could Condorcet is actually a family, a type of election method. There are lots of specific ones, and we just said let's use pure Condorcet, meaning if there is a clear Condorcet winner, we'll use that, and if there isn't, we'll just do a re-election with the leading options or something. Because the understanding was that's very rare; it shouldn't happen under normal circumstances, and we also decided to include a further discussion option in the election. So instead of, in addition to the seven models, there would also be a further discussion option. Sort of the real reason that was added was to show that nobody wanted to discuss this anymore, because people were getting tired of discussing this for months and wanted to know, okay, this is how we're going to do it. Let's go forward and get back to actually, you know, programming and stuff. So this is my biggest contribution. I'm written as an author on the PEP about how we were elected, and I'm right there between Raymond Hettinger and Tim Peters, which is a huge thing for me. Great respect for them. And also I want to shout out at this point to Christoph Groth, who couldn't take part directly in the conversation because it was on the committer's thread on discuss.python.org. where a lot of these discussions were held, but he just wrote an email to several of us and sort of helped move the discussion forward and bring us towards Condorcet, which ended up being a good decision. So thanks, Christoph. And just to show, I mean, why we didn't go ahead with IRV, this is a simulation done by Ka-Ping Yi, who was once a very active Python developer, showing simulated results of elections with different voting systems. And you can see that the one on the bottom right, which is HARE or IRV, does some weird things in lots of cases. I mean, all of those disjointed yellow pieces and squiggly lines, broken lines, mean that very small changes in the voting can completely change the outcome and then back again, and all sorts of weird phenomena, which was very worrying to several of us. And the Schultz method, which we were thought to use, which is a Condorcet method, is just really complex. This is from the Wikipedia page. If you look at how you actually calculate who won, it's this really complicated graph algorithm that, I mean, I read it seven times and I still didn't understand it. And that's why we decided, well, we'll just do pure Condorcet. And if there isn't a direct, all this complexity is sort of to deal with a case where there isn't a clear winner, how to choose the best option anyways to avoid having another election. We said, let's not do that. Let's just have another election if we need it. And in the end, we chose the steering council model. It's kind of surprising for me because it was the last one suggested. And before that, it was kind of obvious, okay, we'll either choose a new BDFL or a council or something. So this was a bit surprising, and the nice thing is this is based on the Django governance model. This is what Django does, more or less. So we had a clear Condorcet winner. There were two close runner-ups, which was the community model with the experts and the trios. And further discussion, nobody wanted further discussion, almost nobody. It was clearly the last. So everyone was just really want us to make a decision. So going back to how the process worked out. So we have PEP 8001, which says, how do we make this decision? And the steering council model is how we are going to be governed. And then we have the steering council itself, which is these five people who've been chosen as the first Python steering council. So since this is our governance model, what do we have now? This is the mandate for the steering council. I'm not going to read it all out loud, but basically it's what I said before. They're supposed to put in processes to make things happen rather than decide directly as much as they can. And they're responsible for a lot of things, but not everything. But they do act as a court of final appeal when all other methods of decision have failed. What are their powers? How can they do this? They can accept or reject PEPs, enforce the code of conduct, and so on. They can delegate a lot of their work, and they work with the PSF. But again, they should look for ways to use this power as little as possible. So what does the power structure look like now? Or the governance diagram, whatever. So if before we had the BDFL at the top, Guido, and he was both the president of the PSF and the BDFL of the core team. Now we have a steering council and the core team, and they're sort of in parallel. The core team elects the steering council. The steering council makes all the has the final word on decisions affecting the core development. But actually, the core team is a bit should be a bit higher there on the diagram, because the core team has the final authority, and I'll get to that in a bit. So who are these two groups now? The core team is the same as the core developers or the committers. We changed how core developers are accepted. They now need to be voted in by 2/3 majority of the existing core developers. And if they haven't, there are still no terms. Once you're accepted as a core developer, you're never kicked out. But if you're not active, you'll probably be considered inactive and encouraged not to take part in votes. And on the other hand, the steering council are 5 people who make decisions by majority votes and so on. And there's this nice thing that no more than 2 of them can be employed at the same company to avoid, Microsoft buying GitHub and silently controlling the Python steering council or something like that. The responsibilities, well, the core team is still responsible for the actual development. I mean, this is what we've been doing for a while, and this is a ton of stuff. And, you know, occasionally programming as well. And this is something that came up a lot in the discussions. We wanted to have a minimal overhead for the core development team because they need to do all of these things and they need to develop Python and ideally, you know, vote in elections and consider the options and so on as little as possible. Spend as much as little of their energy on this because most of us are volunteers. We're doing this in our free time on a volunteer basis, so we shouldn't be spending that time doing things that we don't have to. Let's try to minimize that. And then the steering council, mostly deal with the high-level decision-making and liaising with the PSF and establishing processes. And this is the balance of power. I've mentioned this. The important thing to mention here is that PEP 13, which is our constitution, sort of. This is the actual governance model. The only ones who can change that is the core development team. The steering council can't do that. So while the core team can kick out the steering council, one member or the whole thing, and the steering council can kick out a core developer, that's sort of the balance of power. In the end, the final authority rests with the core developer team. So this is our steering council. It's sort of hard to see in this picture, but these are the people. Barry Warsaw, Brett Cannon, Carol Willing, Guido, and Nick Coughlin. It's very nice to have Guido still on the steering council, at least on the first one, because people still look up to him. People still very much value his opinions. And he took a very, very big step back since that email in July, but it's very nice to have him there. To just get things moving along. Thank you. Okay, we have time for questions, so any questions? So Benny is asking, in reference to what's happening in Israel now with elections, whether this can be used in other domains. So one of the reasons we spent a lot of time thinking about this and discussing it was after we realized, well, lots of other projects are probably going to be looking at what we've decided to do with governance. I will say that, for example, the IRV voting system is used in some places to elect mayors or officials. So at least in terms of the election system, that definitely has an impact. I don't see countries sort of using these kind of governance models, but definitely other projects, open source or otherwise, can learn and are learning from each other, so I think it will have an effect. Any more questions? Yeah. So who will lead large changes, large projects? That hasn't really changed, I think. Mostly, first, the process is that first people bring up an idea, and usually it's discussed on Python Ideas. And that's where often Guido would shoot down things and say, no, this is never going to happen. That's probably still going to happen. But if something is, you know, often either people say, yeah, this is a great idea, or, you know what, let's start developing this and see what it looks like, then it's really up to just someone to pick up the ball and do it. And it doesn't have to be a core developer. Large things have come into the Python, the standard library or the core, just because people started doing it. The best, the most important thing is to get the core developers and the contributors on board during the process, get their feedback early and often. But I don't think there's a major change there. All right, thank you.